Hi, this is Mr. Judd, and this is a corn snake. It can unhinge its jaw and take in its prey all in one bite. It also has these backwards pointing teeth that help as the prey struggles, so it can only go one way, and that's down. This video is about trophic relationships or feeding relationships. Let's start off with a simple food chain. We have a five-link food chain here, and it shows the trophic levels or feeding levels. The first level always has to be a producer or a plant that makes the food. The food then goes up the food chain, and make sure you have your arrows going in the right direction. The arrows show the movement of materials and energy through the food chain. It starts with who makes it and goes up to each of the trophic levels. One of the things you need to be able to do with a food chain is make some predictions. So let's say we go on a rattlesnake roundup and we kill off all of the rattlesnakes. Well, what effect would that have? The first effect is that the birds of prey, who are the top carnivores, will have no more food because there's no more rattlesnakes. They might go locally extinct. Now let's talk about the mouse population. The mice, well, they were being eaten by the rattlesnake. So no longer are they being eaten. Their numbers might go up. If the mouse population goes up, how is that going to affect the level below them? Well, there's going to be more mice and they're going to be eating more. So the next level, the herbivores, they might go down. And if the herbivores go down, they're going to be eating less plants and the plants might go up. This is called a trophic cascade. It's a series of events set in motion by a change in a food chain. A more accurate way to show the feeding relationships within an ecosystem is in a food web. It's just a bunch of interconnected food chains. In this food web, let's focus on, say, the mice. Let's say that their population goes down. What effect might that have? Well, the two things that feed on them, the foxes and the birds of prey, well, they might also go down because they have less food to eat. And if the mice go down, what they eat, the plants down here that looks like grass, well, their population might go up. And you could follow this along. Everything that relies on the grass for food might then go up. So in a food web, the changes are a lot more complex, and in fact, the whole ecosystem becomes more stable because if one thing goes up or down, it doesn't have a drastic effect like it did in a food chain. So that takes us to this really interesting infographic. It's called "What Are We Eating?" and it's about the average American diet. The most interesting part to me is right here in the middle, and that is in the middle of the scale, it shows that the average American eats almost 2,000 pounds of food every year. The outside of this diagram shows the makeup of that food, what types of different foods that the average American is eating. So this might be an interesting or weird fact. Almost 2,000 pounds of food? Well, we don't gain 2,000 pounds every year, so what's going on here? Well, let's bring in our average American and let's show the 2,000 pounds of food to 1,000 pounds of food going in their mouth. This is kind of like our food chain. What happens to that food? Well, a huge amount of it gets released as waste, and that waste is solid or liquid. One thing that you may not think about, but is true, is that you actually exhale some of that as carbon dioxide and it has some weight. So you're losing materials that way too. So those are the main two ways you're losing the materials. What about the energy? 2,000 pounds of food has a lot of calories. So in the energy side of this, you are using the energy for your metabolism. It's running your body. And all the while, you are losing heat. So heat is being released. So the energy that comes in is eventually lost as heat. And on balance, the average American is gaining, yes, as I said gaining, 1 to 2 pounds of food, of weight, every year on average. So if you wanted to maintain a stable weight, you should probably be eating a little less than 2,000 pounds, but not much because most of that, remember, is going to be lost as waste and carbon dioxide, and the energy is going to be burned off for your metabolism and released as heat. So the key point here is you don't get to keep all of the food that you eat. Let's take this concept to a natural ecosystem. We have the sun powering the producers, the plants down here. And let's say that they can make about 10,000 calories, that's energy, 10,000 calories worth of food. Okay. Now, they are going to be eaten by the herbivores, but do they get all of that energy? No. At every level, about 90% of the energy is lost due to heat. Now, I know that plants aren't warm-blooded, but they still lose heat energy through their own metabolism. They have chemical reactions happening 24/7. So that leaves 10% left for the herbivores. So what's 10% of 10,000? It's pretty easy. You just knock off a zero. It's about 1,000 calories for the herbivores. And it doesn't stop there, because the herbivores also are losing about 90% of their energy as heat. And that leaves only 10% of that left for the carnivores. So they're left with, well, I'll take off another zero, 100 calories of food energy. And that is not very much when you consider that the producers in this ecosystem had 10,000 calories. So the basic idea is there's less and less energy available as you move up the trophic levels. Now let's take this to our original food chain. This is a simplified version of it. We took the birds of prey out, but these bars, they represent how much energy is available to each of the levels of the food chain, or each of the trophic levels. It's measured in joules, which is the metric unit for energy. You can see that in this diagram, the plants have way more energy than all of the rest of the trophic levels combined. And at the very top, there's only 10 joules left of energy for the rattlesnake. This is why food chains can't be very long. Eventually, you're going to run out of food. The classic shape that this makes, you might see it this way, is what's called a trophic pyramid. A trophic pyramid shows the amount of energy available at each trophic level, and it gets less and less as you move up. The last thing I want to talk about is a similar pyramid thing, except this is about biomass, and bio is life, and mass is material, so this is living material. We're going to support 50 grams of human tissue. That's not a whole human, it's just some portion of it. But that human is eating chickens, but those chickens are eating grains. So it takes, in this biomass pyramid, about 1,500 grams of grain to support 50 grams of human tissue. So it takes a lot of plants to support a human. Let's bring this concept back to that infographic. And if you didn't notice this on first glance, you might notice it now when I draw this line. This line divides our diet. These are plant foods, and these are animal foods. The question could be asked, which is the most efficient way to eat? Should you be eating plants, or should you be eating animals? Well, in an ecological sense, if you eat plants, you have way more energy and nutrients and material available to you, because these plants could alternatively be fed to animals, and then we could eat the animals. But there's a huge loss of energy and materials when you eat higher up in the trophic levels. So that's trophic relationships, and I hope that's helpful.